Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order. At this time, I'm going to have the invocation if we bow our heads, please. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for all our many blessings, Lord, and we just ask that you give us the knowledge and the wisdom to do what's right for Alamance County. And, Lord, we pray for our military in the foreign countries and for this what's happening over there now, Lord. We just ask that you intervene in that stuff. And, Lord, just help us each day as we plan our day that we can live for you, Lord. And in thy holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Next is public comments. Mr. Childers. And just remind you, you have 3 minutes.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'm going to speak about the, Mr. Albright's going to speak on the county line. I don't know what he's going to talk about, but what I'd like to say is that this issue really needs to be put to rest as quickly as possible. I was not in agreement with the decision, the so-called 91% or something decision that came through, which basically I've characterized as the Ninth Street solution. It certainly didn't take everybody's considerations along that line. Certainly it handled the people up in 9th Street and Mebane. But in any event, Orange County had a commissioner's meeting several weeks ago where a resident of Morro Mill, just south of me, was wanting them to reopen the issue concerning the Morro Mill residents who were upset about, you know, being moved to another county. They didn't get the 9th Street solution. But in any event, the commissioners at that meeting kind of thought they could reopen the issue of Morro Mill. And I think the decision was to send a letter to Alamance County about this issue. It was interesting, though, they didn't make it a resolution. It was just an issue. So I don't know if they were just trying to appease that particular homeowner and make like they were going to do something when they really aren't intending to do anything serious about the issue. But this needs to come to closure as quickly as possible. I mean, there have been enough buyers blindsided by this county line issue, buying homes in a county that they're not ending up in. There's a lot of money at stake. I mean, there are property issues, school issues, and all sorts of things, property value issues and everything else that goes on there. So I'm hoping this issue is moving along. I hope we can get it kind of done this year completely. And I would urge commissioners not to, Orange County, from what I've seen, has really been a stick in the mud on this thing and forcing this thing out longer and longer than they should be. They have not really been rational in their thinking on this issue all along. So I would urge also commissioners that if anything comes up to try to reopen decisions that have already been made or you know, do something about Morro Mill residents, although I feel sorry for Morro Mill residents, quite frankly, they didn't get what they wanted. But in any event, this issue needs to be put to rest, and we need to move on. And that's just my comments for this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Gilbert. Thanks. Do I have the commissioner's comments about it? Mm-hmm. Anybody?
Craig, what's the latest? I thought we had resolved that issue and it was over and completed.
Clyde's going to talk about it.
Okay.
Yeah, we're
okay.
Giving an update where
the two local bills are now.
Okay.
It's on the agenda. Is that all right? Okay. If no more other questions responses, we'll go on to number 5, which is the discussion of the secondary road pavings. And if Mr. Mills and another gentleman would come forward. Hello.
Hello, good evening. My name is Mike Fox, and I'm your Division 7 representative on the State Board of Transportation. And I wanted to come over tonight. This is my first opportunity to present this report to the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I do recognize a couple of you from just acquaintances. I know Mr. Boswell's on the MPO, and we've worked with him together before, too. But I know that Alamance County has been taken care of well over the years. And Mr. Gallion, when he was the board member, I know many of you met him, and I wanted to make sure that you knew that I was available should you have concerns or questions. We're fortunate we have a great division and district staff, and both our division engineer and our district engineer are here tonight to answer any questions you have about our secondary road program. And with that, unless you have any questions for me on the board issues in general, I'll turn it over to Mike Mills, our division engineer, and he's going to talk about the specifics of what we would propose to pave in secondary roads. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. My name is Mike Mills, division engineer with DOT. We do have with me tonight also Brad Wall, our division maintenance engineer, and Chuck Edwards, our district engineer for Alamance County. I hope everyone has the 2009 and 10 and also 10 and 11 program we sent out. That's it. We came to y'all several years ago. Last time was to do the 7-8 and 2008 and 9 program. We're now here to present the 2009-2010 and 10 and 11 program. And if I may, I'll just go down the list, Ms. Chairperson, and tell what we got on the plan on doing. You will notice that we do have $2,752,750 available to do these 2 years' worth of roads. The first one you'll see is Carl Madron Road. That's just to complete the funding that we started on 2 years ago. This will complete the funding on that one. And then you'll see right away number 8, Jones Lane. That just means that was on the hold list at one time, and now people have said they will sign the right away, so we put it back on the program. And then we go down the list. 1F is John Sutton Road. 2F is Ballpark Dead End Road. 3F is Zachary Lane. 4F is Jim Barnwell Road. 5F is Joe Mitchell Road. 6F is Willard Isley Road. 7F is Johnson Road. 8F is Railroad Street. 9F is Roselle Road. 10F is Wilkins Road. And if I can just give you a little update on what the F means. When we do our priority ratings every 4 years, we always freeze the next 10 roads in priority order. And that's what the F stands for. Those are frozen, so we don't rank those. They're just frozen on the list. Start with number 11 is Holyfield Road. Number 12 is Braxton Lane. Number 13 is McBain Mill Lane. Number 14 is Cleve Road. 15 is Bowling Wood Lane. 16 is Sankey Road. 17 is Mebane Airport Road. 18 is Hutchins Road. 19 is Woody Drive. 20 is Carl Madron Road. 21 is Mount Pleasant Church Road. 22 is Austin Quarter Road. 23 is a no-name road. SR-2429 does not have a name associated with it. Number 24 is Troxler Lane. 25 is Tula Lambert Road. And 26 is Thomas Road. Now, all of these are rural roads, and it's 8.4 miles for a subtotal of $2,425,000. Then next, we do the subdivision roads. There's only two roads in Alamance County that we have on our state system that are subdivision roads. One of them is Callaway Drive, proposing to pave that one, and number 2 is Mountain Trail. And both of those roads were recently added in the last 2 or 3 years to our state system. With that, we're proposing having about $60,000 in contingency funds to do other roads that need to be added to the system. We can participate in that, paving rural or fire department driveways, and so on. So, Madam Chairperson, that is our 2009 and 10 and 10 and 11 secondary road paving program. We've got to answer any questions at this time.
Do you have any information about that other one that you know what I'm talking about?
We have investigated that one. Based on the house counts that's out there, it's about 32 homes. So normally on those type roads, we can participate. We normally It's in the range of $1,200 to $1,500 per house that we can participate on, just like we did Callaway Drive and Mountain Trail. That one is, we can participate, I think, $45,000. Estimated cost is about $200,000. I'm going to send a letter out, and I would recommend or propose that we sit down and meet with you, Representative Engel, Jason Martin, anybody and everybody that wants to get on that meeting to find out what we want to do on that particular subdivision.
Okay. Is that in the Lakeview area?
It's Lakeview Estates.
Lakeview Estates.
Mm-hmm. You knew I was going to ask you.
I know.
And he was ready for
you. He was.
Well, this is a public hearing, so I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Anybody got any questions? Well, I didn't realize a public hearing.
There's several people here today, I think, on the Callaway Pollard situation. Can you give a time frame to them as to when you think that'll be completed?
Chuck, I'd like Chuck to address that if you can.
Once we can get the project funded, we should be able to complete that by this summer or fall.
Is there any possibility that there's always a possibility that. Is it almost absolutely funded, or is it a budget crisis? Can that play any effect on any of this?
Well, all can play effect into it. But,
I admit it.
But I think if everything stays the way it is,
right.
That and it is on the program. Right. So once we get the resolution from the county supporting our program, we'll submit it to the board for approval. Depending on when we get it, it may make the April board meeting, but it'll definitely make the May board meeting. So once we do that, then Chuck can set up and order the stone and do all that. We already got the right-of-way on both roads, so that's not an issue.
Are you in Graham? Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
He's right down the street.
Okay.
Turn to Wendy's.
We feel comfortable that we could have that completed by summer, fall this year.
Any more questions? Okay, thank you, Mr.
Brooks. If we can get a resolution.
All right.
Okay.
So
moved. I'll make the motion.
Second.
All right. I have a motion in a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
All. Thanks, Mike.
Okay. Is Ginger Booker here?
Yes.
Hey, there you are. I missed you. Hey, girl. You're up next.
They told me to come to the front row.
Okay. I missed you when you got over there. And what this is about is the dissolution of the PTCOG and the formation of the new Piedmont Triad.
Thank you, Madam Chairman and members of the Commission. Many, if not all of you, attended a full briefing that we had for Alamance County Commissioners and City Councils in Alamance County back in September. On plans to merge the two councils of governments that now serve the Piedmont Triad region. Our local government organizations, the Northwest Piedmont COG and the Piedmont Triad COG, hope to merge to form a 12-county organization, just as is the case with a private sector Piedmont Triad partnership and with transportation. Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation. Your chair, Ms. Massey, is a member of the executive committee of our Piedmont Triad Council of Governments. She sat in on a number of formal and informal conversations about this subject and has probably told you about many of them. What you have before you are two resolutions to make the legal merger take place. And the exact same thing is happening in all seven counties and our local governments, 46 local governments in our Council of Governments, and the 27 over in the Northwest COG. The first resolution dissolves the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments effective the 30th of June, transfers our assets and liabilities to resolution number two, a new Piedmont Triad Regional Council serving 12 counties effective July the 1st. So you have those two resolutions. I'll be pleased to answer any questions about them.
I have one. I didn't see anything about Burlington and how they were going to get into this, or can you give me, I know they have to have at least 50,000. Can you explain that?
They already voted for it.
Burlington and Graham have already voted for it, and Mebane has it on their agenda tonight. The way the charter is written is that cities with a population of 50,000 or more have an automatic place on the executive committee. They're already in the whole organization. So giving a 50,000 population city an automatic spot on our executive committee is actually a little bit new. That was going to give Burlington a guaranteed spot. And as I understand it, they're 38 short.
Oh, no.
I think. Isn't that right? From the census? Now, that's not final. There's going to be some recounts. But the bottom line is this. Right now, Burlington happens to be on our executive committee because they are chosen by Alamance County to do that. If they make the 50,000 mark, they'll have an automatic spot. If they don't, it'll be the same way it has been. But they've already voted to pass the resolutions.
So then we could appoint. We could vote to have a
delegate from there. Alamance County will have a person on our executive committee no matter what.
Right.
And depending on Burlington's population, either they go in a pool and you all figure out which municipality from the county you want to be on the executive committee.
Okay.
Or they have an automatic spot.
Okay.
I would like to ask a question concerning that. Tell us what is the advantage for Alamance County belonging to that? The only thing I've ever seen that y'all's group do is try to add things to the taxpayers to force them to pay more taxes. I've never seen them do anything to help the homeowners. I'd like you to tell me one thing that they've ever done.
Well, we don't have much at all to do with the tax base. Here is something we do for Alamance County, and we do it for every county in our region. We are what is known as the Area Agency on Aging. About $860,000 come through us every year to Alamance County that you use for things like senior centers, nutrition meals, Meals on Wheels, Nursing Home Advisory Committee. That has nothing to do with your tax base. You get the money, and then our staff, we provide ombudsman to protect the rights of your nursing home residents, your adult care home residents. We staff your Nursing Home Advisory Committee. We staff your County Aging Advisory Committee that has to do with money and services to senior centers. So that's one cluster of things we do. Another cluster of things we do has to do with all kinds of environmental issues. For example, Alamance County and most of the Triad were about to be designated several years ago as a non-attainment area for ozone. No big surprise. Cars going all up and down the interstate.
That meant he missed.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
About to be designated a non-attainment area for ozone, which is an air pollution. If the Triad and Alamance County had been designated non-attainment, that could have, worst case scenario, affected transportation dollars that you get. It could have affected your eligibility to bring in new industry because they have to go through certain environmental checks. The Piedmont Triad Council of Governments, with a vote from your commissioners, in the space of about 3.5 weeks, organized a triad-wide air quality compact. We worked for about 5 years with all the counties in our region, kept the county from and other counties in triad from being designated a non-attainment area for ozone. Another thing, there's so many things we've done. Another area that, of course, is of huge interest here in Alamance County, particularly to the municipalities, is the Jordan Lake Rules, viewed with favor by some and disfavor by others. Like your county staff, we work in the political arena, so we have to balance those interests. But we spent the better part of 18 months working with Alamance County communities and municipalities, with the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, to get the best compromise possible on those Jordan Lake rules, moving back the effective date to finally 2016. Now, given the political climate in Raleigh, there is some interest in moving the implementation back even further, and we're going to be in that arena. So I could go on and on, but you don't want me to. What we do has virtually nothing to do with your tax base. We get the Council of Governments gets the money we have because you pay us membership dues. We earn the money in consulting money. We get all of about $25,000 from the state of North Carolina. So we are a membership association. We know whom we serve, and we don't depend on handouts from the federal government for our budget. So I hope that answers your question.
Dollar-wise, how much are we contributing right now to the?
Our bids are about $14,000.
This new one, was that in our ginger bat? Was it 22 cents, 21 cents? What was it for population?
The dues for 20-some-odd years have been 21 cents per capita. When we merged the COG, in order to have a revenue-neutral source of income, over on their side, they had this very complex due structure, graduated due structure. So we're going to have, across all 12 counties, a 22-cent per capita dues increase, which means you all are going to pay us $1,000 and some change extra.
So we're up to $15,000, roughly. And have the other counties signed? How many of the other counties have signed on today for the change?
No, let me see. Just because of when the boards of commissioners meet, you all actually are our first county. It is on the consent agenda for Davidson County tomorrow night. They've already talked about it in their small groups. Alamance, Randolph and Montgomery the 14th and the 15th, Guilford's the 17th. We've already, in terms of municipalities, have Greensboro, Burlington, Graham, a number of smaller municipalities.
Do you do anything to promote the area, or is that just, are you more of a liaison for government services, or do you branch over into any recruitment for the area, or if you could just, in a sentence or two, say what your mission is. If you had to state publicly what your mission is for our group of counties, how would you phrase that?
This is going to be a test, because you can go to our website and check our mission statements. The question is whether I can remember it. The mission statement of the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments is to provide services both local and region-wide to local governments, urban and rural, in the Piedmont Triad region. So we are a local government organization. That is whom we serve, with both localized things. If you want us to come in and do a position pay and classification plan for your staff, we'll do it. Regional things, Jordan Lake rules, air quality. We do not get into promoting the region or industrial recruitment, because that belongs to the Piedmont Triad Partnership.
Right. What about the County Commissioners Association and the League of Municipalities? Do you have any links or coordinated efforts with them? We do.
Every single month throughout the state, the directors of the 17 COGs meet in Raleigh to talk about a lot of things. The day after the COG directors meet, there is a local elected official from each region that comes in to talk about statewide issues of regional interest. Always in that case, either the attorney or the CEO of the League of Municipalities and the County Commissioners Association are there. So even, if, for example, when practical things come up, like the Jordan Lake rules, as I said, we worked our fingers to the bone to try to get them as moderate as we can. Now there's a chance they could be rolled back a little bit more. We're in full communication with the League of Municipalities about that.
Where will your office be, the new office?
We don't know. If you draw a concentric circle and put a dot in the middle of the target, it would be near the airport or Kernersville. But it is, as you might imagine, all we can do to get budgets merged. We've got to get a position pay and classification plan to make our staffs be comparably paid. So if we can get that pulled together, we'll spend the next number of months identifying a good location.
Right now it's on Meadowwood.
It's on Meadowview.
You're
Meadowview.
In Carolina building, aren't you?
We're in the Wilmington building, which is very, very accessible. Accessibility is a big deal when we merge, too.
Now, our company used to have an office underneath yours. Is that the first building on the right off of High Point Road?
It is.
Road?
Yeah. It is.
You were upstairs, and our office was downstairs.
Yeah. Well, now we have a city council person from Pleasant Garden down under us. So. Right.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion, if one's in order, actually, for this board to approve the two resolutions, one to dissolve the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments and also to approve the formation and membership in the Piedmont Triad Regional Council.
I have a motion.
Moved.
For both of them.
Second.
Second. All in favor say second. Aye.
Thank you very much.
Aye.
No aye for me.
And you say no.
I'm going to say no.
Okay.
No.
All in favor say no. I'm sorry. Okay. Have one no and four.
Okay.
You can say that. I got goat on TV. That commercial kills me.
Okay. Thank you, Ginger. That was very informative. Thank you, everybody. Okay, at this time, I'm going to open the public hearing for the Watershed Protection Ordinance Amendments, and Mr. Martin is here.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. In your package, you should have a memorandum from me explaining the amendments that are being proposed to the Watershed Ordinance, as well as a copy of the ordinance, and I'll direct you to pages 3. You should see it highlighted in yellow, one change there, and then on page 12, the other. In January of 2011, the Environmental Management Commission approved this proposal for bringing the riparian buffer requirements in compliance with the Jordan Lake rules. And as you'll recall, we kind of did a lot of back and forth on this over the last year to get something that would work with the Environmental Management Commission. And just to briefly cover the two changes to the ordinance, they are very, very short. Section 102, which again is on page 3, exceptions to applicability. We're adding a subsection E, which will state exceptions listed in this section shall not apply to the requirement of riparian buffers as set forth in section 204 of this ordinance, which leads to the second change, which is on page 12, and that's retitling that. Originally it said just stream buffer. This will now say stream and pond buffer, because ponds are required to be buffered under the Jordan Lake rules. And I just will add real quickly, that is referring to ponds that are stream fed. Anyhow, that next section says the riparian buffer protection rules of 15A NCAC 02B .0267 and .0268 and section 6G of Session Law 2009-216 found in section 7B of Session Law 2009-484, Jordan Water Supply Nutrient Strategy applies to all lands regulated by this ordinance. And that is specifically stating just the areas that are currently water supply watershed that we are currently enforcing this ordinance in, will the county be enforcing the buffer rules. Now, this does apply throughout the rest of the county with the exception of a very small corner in the northeastern part of the county, which is not included in the Jordan watershed. Those other areas are being enforced by the Division of Water Quality. The county did have the option to take all of that on, but as you know, we staff and the planning board both recommended not to do that until we know just how much this is going to cost. One thing I did want to mention, I did receive a phone call today just in reference to agricultural farming and uses, and I did want to state as well, just a reminder that this ordinance specifically exempts bona fide farming, and also even under the state's rules for riparian buffers, they are exempted out of that. This is referring to new development. There are going to be rules that will apply to agriculture. Right now, that there is an oversight committee that is being handled by Phil Ross over at the Ag Extension Office. I believe Jane Isley is on that board, and Frank Bell and a few other people. And they are working with the state right now to develop those goals and rules. So I did want to just reemphasize that this does not apply to bona fide farming and agricultural uses. So with that, I also will direct you to the end of the packet. You will see a resolution in there titled A Resolution Supporting the City of Greensboro in Revising and or Repealing the Jordan Lake Watershed Rules. For the sake of time, I will not read this entire resolution unless, Madam Chair, you wish for me to do that. But
I've read it also.
I think one of the main points in that, Jason, is the fact that we're not set up to handle what the state has asked for as far as manpower to oversee some of these things.
I would definitely agree with that statement.
Yeah.
And with that, I will be glad to take any questions that the board has at this time.
Yes, since this is a public hearing, you might sure. have any questions, Mr. Martin? Is a public hearing.
Are those proposals available to the public? Mm-hmm. What's your
proposal? Oh, that I've presented tonight?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I'd be more than glad to give them to you.
Yeah,
like okay. I'll get with you as soon as we're done.
I would like a copy as well.
Okay.
Here's two more.
I would also. I want one also.
Yeah, this is actually on the website in the commissioner's packet as well.
Can you give us the site? Can you give us the URL?
Yes, www.alamance-nc.com. And then go under the section that says County Commissioners and click on Meetings. And you'll see the link to the agenda and to the packet as well there. And I believe this is on pages, see how good my memory is, 16 through 46 of the packet, if I remember correctly.
I didn't think you read it, but no.
It should have been at the very end of it.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Does this cover Jordan Creek up in North Park County?
It covers the Jordan Lake rules cover everything with the exception of a very small corner there. It's about 99.8% of the county is covered with the Jordan Lake rules.
Okay.
So I believe it does include that.
Okay. Another question. We have a creek running through the back part of the farm.
Mm-hmm.
It is a sand pit back there. Mm-hmm. Nothing can be grown in it except what trees are produced there now.
Mm-hmm.
Is there something that needs to be done there or can be done there?
No, as of this time, basically anything that is being used for its current use can remain the way it is. If you were to go in and change the use of the property or to, you know, cut down or anything like that, that may, you know, cause there to be some additional requirements under this. But right now, as it stands, you're not changing anything.
Is it something that can be done to help improve that?
We are working with the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership, which they are also offering a program called Buffer in a Bag, which they've received from grant funding to make available to people to be able to get seedlings and things like that to plant in those buffer areas to help boost and strengthen the riparian buffers.
One thing I'll stop. Whose responsibility is it to clean the creeks out? Is it
to clean the creeks out?
Creeks out where the water runs and it keeps flooding, you know, debris and all getting the creeks.
Landers.
Yeah, I would say the landowner. Yeah, there's been no other talk of anything else.
Responsibility.
Any other questions of Mr. Martin?
Those questions back there.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I have two questions. First, these proposed rules in any way modify the existing buffer zones around the Quaker Lake Reservoir?
Around the lakes, it does not affect the lake rules. We're dealing strictly with just the streams and ponds. In terms of, just to kind of give a quick explanation on this, the current rules under the watershed ordinance apply a 50-foot undisturbed buffer on all perennial streams, meaning there's water flowing in that stream year-round. The proposal will also apply to intermittent streams, which don't flow year-round. Now, so it is an expansion of the buffers to intermittent streams. However, this will also now be split into two zones. There will be a zone one and a zone two. Zone one is the first 30 feet from the bank of the creek. That must remain undisturbed. So the undisturbed area is actually shrinking. And then the remainder of the 20 feet is managed vegetation, to be able to go in and clear out. And of course, even in the undisturbed areas, if trees were to die or something like that, there's nothing to say that that can't be removed and something planted back. Because the worst thing could happen would be a diseased tree infect everything, and then you lose the whole buffer. But it does not apply to any additional regulations around lakes. Right now, that is staying the way it is in the ordinance. So, and basically, that already meets the Jordan requirements.
The second question I have is, I understand from your previous comment that a pond that is only rain-fed.
Stream-fed.
No, my question is that a pond that is only rain-fed, not stream-fed, would not be subject to these rules.
Right, if it was just a stormwater wet detention pond, something like that, that's not affected on this. Only ones that are at the head of the stream.
I have a question. Can a landowner right now harvest existing trees right along a stream?
No.
Yeah,
on a perennial stream, they cannot.
2 or 3 months ago, could they have?
No. It's been undisturbed on perennial streams.
Right.
As long as I've been with the county, since at least 2003.
Yeah.
So what does a neighbor do if another neighbor is harvesting trees right on the
shared
creek?
You could call the Department of Environmental Natural Resources.
I would say you can start with me, and we'll be glad to investigate that.
And I promise you he'll do something.
That would
be wonderful. The gentleman in the back has
Yes, sir. I live on the river down close to Saxbahaw, and it's grass. Mm-hmm. And I mow right up to the river edge. Mm-hmm. Can I continue on or what?
Yes, sir. From my understanding of speaking with the state of North Carolina, I specifically asked that question of them, is that as long as you continue to do that, you can do that. If you're doing it currently and you continue the same use, absolutely. Wow. But if you were to leave it grow for 2 years or something like that, then the rule changes. So.
They don't have to come back and dig it up.
Right. Exactly.
Got another question. Riffraff, it comes down the river upstream. Can I move it back into the stream or what? Or burn it?
I honestly don't know. I don't have an answer to that. Based on the state, if you'd like, I'll be glad to take your name and I'll get that answer for you.
Appreciate it, sir.
Sure.
Any other questions?
I make a motion we do the resolution.
No, second.
I need to close the book here.
Jump step on me, didn't
you? Okay.
Make a motion we close public.
Thank you. Exactly. I have a motion and a second, all in favor.
All right.
Now you can.
Now I'll make a resolution supporting us.
See you.
And have a motion and a second on the resolution for different candidates. Need a motion for the memo.
I'll make that motion.
Oh, wait, we have a red one ready.
Okay,
we have a motion and a second on the resolution for City of Greensboro.
Right.
On favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed? Okay, then next I need a motion on the memorandum. All right.
I move.
I have a motion for the memorandum for the Jordan Lake rules.
Second.
And a second. On favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Okay. We've got all that done.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, I will also just say, as I get information as we move forward with this, again, because we are supporting the City of Greensboro in their efforts, I will definitely keep our county manager and the board informed of any changes and developments in that.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Massey.
Yes, sir.
I know this is out of sequence here a little bit, but just so that her comments can be in context with some earlier comments that she made, I'd like for Ms. Booker to, I asked her, was it not true that the COG had been instrumental in the formation of the Randleman Dam project? And if you could comment on that.
I didn't mention it because you all don't drink out of it. But when you have a regional organization that works and people have a sense of trust and credibility, five local governments began knowing that they were going to have huge water shortages 30 years ago, and they tried for a long time to get money from the Corps of Engineers to help fund it. That didn't work out, so they began to meet at our office under leadership of the former Greensboro City Manager, and over a period of about 12 years in our office, the local governments decided to build the Randleman Dam. They worked out a formula of putting in money based on who was going to drink the most water from it. They went through years of storm and turmoil, but that formula they worked out works to this day. We incorporated the Piedmont Triad Regional Water Authority, spun it off, and now they stand on their own.
See, to me, that's their crown jewel.
Uh-huh.
The Army Corps of Engineers had that project on the map. It's been on the drawing board for over a half century.
That's right.
It goes back over 50 years. And I believe it hadn't been for the COG's involvement. And that's the way I found about it. I came in your office one day trying to get maps for the lake. And that's years ago.
It was.
Yeah. And so, you know.
Thank you for mentioning.
And I thought you ought to tell the story on that.
Thank you.
Well, I've been with COG too for 13, 12 years or whatever. So when I was in Harvey, I was with the COG, now I'm with the COG again. So it's a great organization, I have to tell you. It works. So, okay. Next up is MJ with our library fees and fines.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, I have a proposed revision to our fines and fee schedules, and it's mostly just in wording. It's no change in pricing. We've broken some things out. We've taken some things off that we no longer do, and just wanted your approval for that, and if you had any questions about that.
Did we clarify that other issue, too, in here?
Which
about
one?
The lady that... Because she wasn't notified, or we just left that. She wasn't notified.
I think we've gotten that one cleared up. Our policy regarding sending out overdue notices is that it's a voluntary service,
exactly.
And they're still held responsible.
Right.
So I think we've made that point clear.
Yeah, I just wanted to.
I haven't heard from her recently, so I'm assuming it's all straightened out.
Not too long ago, I heard from her.
Yeah, well, we heard from her quite a bit in January, and I think early February.
Yeah.
But
she had other questions about the stuff the City of Burlington control. So.
Madam Chair, move for approval.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those likewise.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jay.
Very easy. Did you get your library card?
I did, and I used it.
Okay. The next is the lease agreement with Peak Resources, and this is about our home that we have.
I'm happy to say that the assistant county attorney has entered into negotiations and completed negotiations with Peak Resources, Inc. to lease the facility formerly leased by Kindred Healthcare.
Okay.
So $456,000 come to the county each year for 5 years.
How much was that?
$456,000.
I read that about three times because I was like, oh.
$38,000 a month. There'll be a 3% increase per year. There's a provision in the lease where they make $350,000 in improvements to the property, which can include personal property such as kitchen equipment and wheelchairs, things of that nature.
Exactly the same use?
Pardon?
Properties will be used for the same
use. It will be used for the same use it is now.
We did add one provision to the lease. We ran into a little problem with the transition from the current tenant to the new tenant in the Medicaid billing number, which is a number the federal government issues and can take up to a year to get. That's all been resolved, but this new lease has a provision in there that if and when Peak Resources terminates the lease, they'll be assigning that number to the new tenant, whoever that tenant may be. So I'd ask for a motion to approve this lease and to authorize the chair to execute the lease on behalf of Alamance County. Okay.
So moved.
Have a motion? Well, second.
I had a question, if you don't mind. Is the insurance adequate? I mean, is that a standard for the company that's doing it as far as the liability issues?
We've looked at that with our broker, and that is a reasonable amount.
So it's $1 million and $3 million total aggregate, something like that.
And they pay for that, too, don't they?
They do.
Yeah, they do.
I did read that.
I know. I just want to make sure we're covered as far as a county, should there be an issue.
I have a motion on the floor and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed likewise. Thank you. All right. Okay.
Yes, county line bills.
Okay. We're ready for you.
All right. Last week, first bill was introduced, Senate Bill 201, House Bill 214.
Excuse me. Can I
deduct, please? Senate Bill 201, House Bill 214. It establishes the common boundary between Alamance County and Orange County pursuant to the resurvey that's going to be done. And this is the so-called 91% solution. If that bill passes, and we have every reason to believe it will, then surveys will be completed, a description of the line will be prepared, and will be recorded in the register deeds in Alamance County and in Orange County. And that'll be it for that portion of the line. The second bill was introduced, Senate Bill 200 and House Bill 213, which is an authorization bill. It gives this board and the Orange County Board the authority to consider, not change anything, consider the so-called 9% of the common boundary between Alamance and Orange County. And you'll have until roughly the end of this year to decide if you want to make any changes with that 9%.
Now, when was that law put into place?
That is a bill.
Or a bill. When was that
bill? That was put in last Thursday.
Okay. Now, weren't we supposed to vote on supporting that being introduced from our?
Well, at our last meeting, I was left with the impression that you wanted that authority so you could address those issues for that 9%. That doesn't commit this board to anything. That just gives you the authority to consider it.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, it was a consensus.
Would you introduce the second bill?
Yeah, I think it was just a consensus.
Yeah, because we've always thought, I've always thought, yeah, that was a consensus.
Well, I was never going to
support it.
But it's the other part that
we're too late when they sent in their letters or that Marmille, which is the one Mr. Childress is talking about, they were totally too late. They didn't come to meet us till the night we were in Mebane. So,
Chair, they've had 2 years.
That's what we're saying. They were too late.
Saying they were late.
Exactly.
They had 2 years.
Yeah.
So you're saying the last meeting we had here, tell me when, because I'm going to go back and look at it.
I'll have to go back and look, but I believe it's the last meeting where we discussed the county line.
I need the date on that, if you don't mind, because I don't remember ever. Now, again, I'm getting older and so forth, but I would have never endorsed with my vote a second bill being put in to change the line again.
Well, this doesn't change the line. It just gives this board the authority to consider.
It gives us authority to change the line again, and I would have opposed that, and I just want to know what date and time and place we talked about that.
I'll get that information.
I just don't remember that.
And you may not have agreed to it, but...
Well, I just want to see it.
Yeah.
Go back and look.
It wasn't a vote taken on it. It was.
I want to just see the time, date, and place when it was discussed.
But if that second bill does not result in changes to the 9%, then the line will remain where the line is today.
Okay. Any questions?
I'd like to say one more thing about this topic. you know, and I know it's over, it's a done deal, at least the 91% is, but, you know, this whole debate was as if this was the only county that had the problem, to a big degree. I'm sorry, that was the tone of the debate, in my opinion. I was sitting over in Archdale the other night, and a lady was standing at the car with me, and I was trying to write a certificate for her daughter. And they had an Archdale address, which is Randolph County, right? And I looked at her, and I said, well, now, Archdale, okay, but you live in Guilford, right?
It could be Guilford, couldn't it?
Okay, wait, let me finish. Okay. She had an Archdale address, and I knew that was Randolph County. Well, the kid's supposed to be in Guilford County schools. So I looked at her, and I said, now, you got an Archdale address here. You live in Guilford, don't you? And she said, well... And I almost didn't, I mean this sort of in jest too, tongue in cheek. She said, well, the house is in Guilford. The backyard is in Randolph. And I said, well, I've got a county manager I want you to meet. And she didn't understand what I was talking about, but I called down to Randolph County, and they've had this debate for years. And they said, we just don't pay any attention to it. She said, if the house is in one county, we bill you, we tax you. If the backyard's in another county, we bill you, we tax you. And that was the way they've always handled it in Randolph. And I just thought I'd need to tell that story. And I don't think it's an anomaly or that, you know, we were the only ones. We hardly were the only ones that had to deal with this, and I think other people handled it more properly than we did. I'll always maintain that position, always, no matter how I get outvoted. Okay. County line was the county line.
Okay.
Thank you.
Next is county manager reports.
We do have an update on our community corrections project.
Just to kind of let you know where we are on that project, we have received bids on both the site work and the modular facility. We have sent out the RFP for the financing of that project last Friday, I believe it was. Those will come in, I think it's the 25th when we'll receive those. We'll come back to the board at your, I believe it's your April meeting, and we'll have a request for you to approve both the contracts for the site work and for the modular unit and the financing for the project. Then the application will go the next day after that meeting to the LGC for their approval. It will take 4 weeks, I think, to receive their approval. Once they approve the project, then we will issue the contracts for the project, and then we'll move forward with that. Expected date of completion will be probably by the end of October. We hope to have the project completed at that time, so that's where we're at.
When does the lease expire on the current building?
There are two different facilities. One of them expires the end, let's see, one of them expires about the middle of October. The other one, I think, expires, I think, the end of June, so we'll have to get an extension on that.
And do we have to get some kind of notice on the one that expires in October as to...
I'll check and see. I think they may have already been notified the one in October because they've been advertising that space will be available. I think it's like October 17th. So I need to check on that and make sure.
So they'll push them on out the door.
That's right.
That's yes.
So anyway, so that's kind of where we are in the project. So.
Okay.
Any questions? Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Okay. Budget.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman and Commissioners. I do want to give you a quick update of where we're at on the upcoming budget year. Again, we have some goals internally as far as management of what we're looking for in this upcoming year's budget, and we're hoping that these goals will also be goals that you'll be looking for and support as well. One is for our tax rate to remain at 52 cents per hundred. Again, as we've talked about in the past, we want to utilize our fund balance at a very minimal to little to none. And again, that was a goal we had this year. But again, as you've seen from our audit, we still need to keep that as a goal in this upcoming year's budget. One of the big things that we would like to work on with your support is trying not to look at mandatory furloughs for our employees. See, again, that's about a 2% reduction for salaries for employees this year. We will not be looking at raises this year again for the third year in a row, but hopefully we won't have to look at reductions, so with the board's support. there's some capital that we do need to look at, and one is hopefully to get your support on is to upfit some of our chassis for our ambulances. And again, that's approximately $75,000 per chassis to mount, to replace the box on a new chassis and to mount. And again, if we look at the average mileage of our entire fleet of 13 ambulances at transport, as of March 1, the average mileage is 186,000 miles. So as you can see, that's probably a priority where we need to look at trying to put our capital dollars in this upcoming year's budget. Again, as there's been a lot of discussion recently, there's issues with the school system that they're having. They have budget shortfalls, and again, they're looking at about a $18 million reduction from the state, but their fund balance has grown. And right now, they have a $14.34 million fund balance. And that is the unappropriated part of their fund balance. I believe the total fund balance is closer to $18 million, but the unappropriated is $14.34 million as of July 1, 2010. Again, our current budget to them is $35.27 million. And again, if you look at that as far as their fund balance being local dollars, that represents almost 40% fund balance that they have. And would like to recommend that we ask ABSS to look at a fund balance policy, that how we can work with them so it doesn't grow as large as their fund balance is right now, since that is local dollars. Again, this is their projected use of school fund balance. If we look at it now, what they're projecting to do, that $14 million will be gone in 4 years. And, you know, there's a concern from management, you know, that we need to work with them to ensure that they don't spend it all. There does need to be some fund balance that does remain. Do understand the pressures that they're under trying to save teachers' positions and TA positions. Understand that, but I think we've got to work with them to find that balance. And again, that's using it all with the not taking into consideration and looking at 4 years that there's probably going to be some growth. They won't use it all, but there should be some growth in the fund balance. You know, instead of using $7 million next year, they may only use $5 million. You know, so again, it's a guessing game to this point. This is our current general fund as a snapshot. We have a $127 million general fund. Expenditures right now, we're at almost $71 million, which is 53% of our total expenditures. And revenues collected, we're at $80.27 million, which is 63%. And again, percentages comparison, we're about at the same percentages of expenditures and revenues as we were this time last year. Again, here's our proposed budget calendar. We have a April 4th retreat set with the County Board of Commissioners, and that will begin at 8:30 at Main Memorial Library on April 4th. And again, after that, there may be a couple other retreats or workshops as requested by the board, but my plan is to present to you a recommended budget to the board on May 2nd. Again, May 16th, ABSS will present its budget to the county. So we'll wait on their final numbers from them on May 16th. That will push our budget schedule back a couple of weeks. So we're looking at a public hearing on June 6th. And then July 1, our fiscal year starts. And again, what is next? We do have a joint meeting with ABSS this coming Friday at 8 a.m. That will be at the school offices on Ball Road. And again, I mentioned our budget retreat on April 4th. It's 9 o'clock, I'm sorry, not 8:30, 9 o'clock. And again, need to work with you to see if the priorities that we're looking for as far as management and, you know, trying to look at non-furlough days, keeping the tax rate, and looking at some capital for EMS, if those are priorities that the board has, or if there's different priorities that you see, or if there's different things we need to add to the budget, we need to know that as well. And then that is it. One of the things that I have done with you, and we've had discussion with the board in the past, and since we're meeting with ABSS on Friday, is discussion of a fund balance policy for ABSS. And currently, there is not a fund balance policy that ABSS has. And last couple of days, since Friday, I've been working with Amy and Tim on trying to come up with what could possibly be a fund balance policy that we could recommend to ABSS. And again, with respect to any fund balance policy, this is a draft. What I've given you up front is a proposed draft. You know, the percentages could change, the time frames could change, the whole thing could change. I've sent a copy of it to Dr. Burns to get his input on it as well to see what he thought. He has not had time to discuss it with his board, so don't have any feedback yet on their thoughts of what their issues may or may not be. Again, any fund balance policy that we have would be a policy of the Board of Education. We can't dictate fiscal policy to them, but we do have the responsibility to make suggestions in areas where we think that that affects our budget as well. So I think we do have that responsibility to make recommendations for them to begin looking at such a fund balance policy. But again, we can't force them to do that. Just an FYI, their current fund balance policy, or their current fund balance, is $18.1 million, with $14.3 being unappropriated. Since 2007-08, their undesignated fund balance has grown $10.7 million. And where ours has gone down, and again, their growth in fund balance is local dollars. And again, in all fairness to the school system, one of the main reasons that they've had the increase over the last couple of years is that they were able to supplement some of their local funds with stimulus funding. So that's one of the reasons that we've been told that why the fund balance has increased so much, especially in the last couple of years. And in the last couple of years, that undesignated has grown by $8.7 million. And again, in fairness to the school system, they have stated that they've been trying to build up a large fund balance, that they knew that this tsunami was coming, that right now I think they're projecting an $18 million shortfall. But again, I think we have the right and also the responsibility to question how that fund balance is being spent and what should it be spent on, especially when we're such a large part of their budget as well. With that said, I'll answer any questions if you have any concerns.
Back on the budget. You're proposing, or tentatively mentioning early here, 52 cents, and then of course doing some capital, not having furlough. How are we able to do that? And I'm glad that we are. Mm-hmm. What are we seeing that's going to keep us from having to have the furloughs, extra revenues, or because we were $4 million short?
This will be a revenue-driven budget. You know, our department heads have done a very good job of cutting expenditures, but it'll be revenue driven, and we're hoping for some good, you know, Gerald has done a wonderful job as far as current and back taxes, so we're seeing a small increase on that. We're also, hopefully, we're waiting on some sales tax figures to come in that'll fully take in Tanger, so we can kind of do some comparison on that. So again, that's what our goals are, but again, not to say that we're going to reach them, but those are kind of where we're hoping to start from.
Craig, what do we have in terms of sales tax information? Through what date so far do you actually have?
We have through part of November, and there was a small increase in part of November, but we haven't seen the full month of November or Christmas yet.
November so. From last November or?
Yeah, November of 10. So, but there was a small increase, but not the increase we were looking for.
So we really just don't know about
that. We don't know. And again, that's what I'm saying. We're kind of, you know, we have goals set out, but again, it's going to be a revenue-driven budget.
Well, you know, Gerald's collections are up some, too.
Gerald's collections are up. You know, it's offset a little bit, as he mentioned at the last meeting, through the loss in vehicles, the valuation. But overall, the collection percentage has increased, and that will help us in next year's budget also.
We do have some people that are taking early retirement, too. Is that?
Yeah, I know.
Well, we're trying to do some things differently. You know, we're still looking at performance-based budgeting and setting up those goals. We've frozen positions now. I think we have about 11 positions that we have frozen between now and July 1. Again, trying to do what we can to save as much money as we can, because, again, we know fund balance is an issue. So we are trying to take those hard cuts up front. So hopefully this budget, you know, depending upon the revenue, will be a little bit better than it was last year.
Good.
Any more questions?
But again, you know, how we deal with the school, you know, that, you know, and if we can work with them on a fund balance policy, you know, if there's ways that they could use it without using local dollars, maybe that could free up, you know, a couple million dollars also. So there's ways, hopefully, we can work with them that can save us on the local end for their funding.
Why don't consider cutting our funds for the schools?
That is an option always.
I agree. I think we need to think about it. If they want to put it in the fund balance, then we're paying too much to the system.
Well, they did put it last year because they knew this year there would be no stimulus coming. I knew that.
Well, let's talk a little bit about this stimulus. I understand that this has come out in a conversation that was held today between Mr. Manning and Craig. How much stimulus money was spent on things that county dollars would have been used for? I thought the stimulus money had more strings attached to it than that.
This particular one, from my understanding, Tim, you help me,
EduJobs. Yeah.
Grant basically was to come in to save positions, mm-hmm. and therefore, unlike a lot of the federal dollars, which are allocated for particular program codes, this was general money that really the school system had no choice but to put it in the local budget because that's where it was going to be spent. So in essence, that replaced the dollars that the county provided for that purpose. And rather, if the school system had said at the time, okay, well, now we've got $6 million from the stimulus money, let's give it back to the county, that in essence would be saying, okay, we're going to take the stimulus money and return it to county government. And I'm not sure that's the right thing to do. I don't know what the answer is, but certainly there's an artificial increase in the fund balance over the past 2 years as federal dollars have replaced local dollars for the same purpose.
Did every county system, every school system have that?
No, you had to apply for it. And you had to apply for it.
Dr. Griffiths worked hard on that.
And, yeah, I mean, you know, when I was on the other side, yeah. we worked hard to encourage, which he did. Dr. Bridges and Sandra Tinsley made a lot of diligent efforts to get as much money as we could. Mm-hmm. But it basically is operating money, and the only place it could be channeled through is the local budget, the local operating budget, because that's what it was going to use for.
And that was for incomes, right?
Primarily for teacher jobs.
Okay.
And it was spread out over more than 1 year.
The county dollars, I mean, the money that we give in our county budget, that's not intended to be for jobs, is it?
We have the local supplement. We have locally paid teachers in addition to what the state provides.
But to cover all, I mean, is it dollar for dollar?
No.
I didn't think it would be.
I broke it down if I'm not mistaken, I think 36%, and I'll have to go back and look at the report, of our local dollars goes for salaries for teachers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And these are good questions that we need to address them. What I would hope, Craig, is that you can get with Dr. Burns and get him to include this discussion when
right.
both boards meet on Friday, because there are a lot of things we need to know.
Right.
Yeah, I think that would be good to have this brought up.
Yeah, I agree.
Friday.
Well, and one of the things, and going back to the EduJobs, I think there's $4.7 million left in that fund that has to be spent by September of this year. So the unappropriated fund balance doesn't even include the $4.7 million in EduJobs, so as far as what's the undesignated. So, but is the school system is our largest expenditure, and you know, we have always...
What percentage is it of our budget?
28%. Not including their debt service.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is accounted for separately with sales tax. So, but, you know, again, I do want to say how much I appreciate the work our department heads have done and their understanding. It is not something that they're not unaware of. You know, they're fully aware of our budget constraints and our budget shortfalls, so I appreciate their understanding also.
Can you get a figure, though, before Friday of what the fund balance would be if they hadn't gotten the grant or spent what they've spent of the grant? Surely that is attainable.
It should be.
Just subtract out the total of the stimulus dollars. Sure.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah,
how much
we can ask that question. Yeah. What? How much money did you get total from EduJobs and stimulus?
Well, and everything else, because right. it is spread out more than right. 1 year, which is
right. We can
2 years. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Next is our consent agenda. Do we want to pull anything on that?
Yeah, the 12B.
As state travel for the health
department.
Mr.
Massey? I haven't seen him.
He has a representative. I think she's over in the other room. Christy Brasher is here.
Christy?
Somebody's
coming. Oh. Hi there, girls.
Mr. Bass is attending the accreditation meeting.
Okay.
So we're just going to stand in his place to answer your questions.
Well, my question is, help me, how many people are going to New York?
It's three total.
Three, and what's the grand total of the dollars involved here?
It should be on the very...
Well, I'm looking at it. It's kind of a confusing array of facts.
Right on the front.
That's 12B.
Yeah.
Okay, I see where it's got Elizabeth...
1894
That's for her, right?
Thank you.
That's for one person?
Yeah.
Yes. That's the...
$1,900 for one person.
The dentist.
Yes, okay. Yes. And then Karen Medlin's going to New York. It's $617.
Yes, right. She's the office manager, and she's here right. today.
So that's 25.
Did y'all... Hang on a second. Did y'all lump together the lodging and the first one?
Yes.
For all three.
Yes, the lodging is for all three.
That's why the variance is in yes. hers. Okay.
Right, and that was to save cost of
and Linda,
three people.
So. That's $617, so that's over $3,000. That's all of it, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And none of this is required?
For the dentist, yes. It is a requirement for her to maintain her licensure.
Okay, I see that now. Okay, the other two is not, right? The other two on the trip.
It's more of a developmental type conference where they gain knowledge on billing, insurance, best practices, just current workflow in terms of managing the clinic.
Yeah. With us being as close to Chapel Hill as we are with their dental school and so forth, was that stuff not available in Chapel Hill?
No, it is not, sir. This is a one-time, I think, a year conference that just happens. They have different locations every year. And this year, I believe it just happens to be in New York.
Now, you can get accredited without going to that. You just have to do something else, right?
I'm sorry. You can
get accredited by doing something else other than going to New York, possibly, right? I mean, you didn't have to. That
I
wasn't...
believe for the dentist, this is a requirement.
This is a specialty mm-hmm. for a pediatric dentist.
Yeah, I was looking at this for pediatric.
Yes.
That's all I have. I'm not going to vote.
Put it back on.
Yeah, we're going to vote.
Okay.
Just, you know, if I'm not mistaken, I read in the paper. No, I like to vote on it. You know, I think we saw where the health department, their budget for travel was, what, $13,000 over where it was last year at this time? Yeah. And I hope that we're going to have some travel expenditures from last, because I don't think we saved near what we thought we'd save. I like to see what we've got for travel.
Keep them on.
Last year, year before, and year to date, or by budget time.
Okay.
People just going everywhere.
At this time, I'll entertain a motion to.
Can I just say one, just to give, make sure you have the information. This request in particular is just for the dental clinic.
I understand.
And so it's separate from the health department's budget. They do not receive any direct local funding. So all the revenue is generated through third-party billing.
Nothing personal. I just.
Oh, no. Just make sure the information.
Our travel for this county is just out of sight. And it's got to stop somewhere. And with my vote, I just have to have more interest, you know, a bigger look.
There are no local funds going to this? Is that what you're saying?
No, this is all third-party.
That's what I thought earlier.
Who's the third party?
It's just third-party insurance. So it's a mixture of patient fees.
And the government. They bill the government.
Yeah, I'm still.
So it's tax dollars.
Do I hear a motion to accept this travel proposal?
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
No.
Okay. I've worked there. I know what goes on.
Yeah, I know too.
Okay, the consent agenda, the rest of the consent agenda, do I have a motion on that?
So moved.
We accept it. I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed likewise? Okay. Next, we're going into closed session.
Need your little paper there.
Get right in.
I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney, the Board of Commissioners, and receive a report regarding the case of RSM versus Alamance County. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye.
We got to talk this.